Hey there. So this video is specifically for folks at sort of an intermediate level. In script, in actuality, the arrangement that I've written for Joyful Joyful, this is almost identical to what I played and to what I originally wrote and to what you'll see in the professional level. There's a few places where I've made some modifications just to make it a tiny bit easier, not a ton, just a little bit easier and a little bit more accessible. And in the attached PDF, it actually says, you know, modified from the original so that you can make note of that. And I'll also make note of that here in this tutorial. The other thing I want to do at this particular level is to, you know, is to not assume that everybody's a strong reader, even professional musicians. There's a ton of professional musicians that I've worked with that they are basically illiterate. They don't read at all, and that's totally, totally fine. So I'll sort of take it upon myself to explain in this particular level, this intermediate level, to make an assumption that maybe reading isn't your strong card. If it is, that's great. The chart is there. It's very explicit. It's got all the dynamics and the articulations and all that. It's got all that stuff. But if reading isn't your strong point, I don't want you to worry. Don't worry. And I'll try to be very succinct and very clear about the shapes that I use and try to refrain from using too much highbrow parlance, as it were. Let's start. So this is in 12 sections. You'll see on the music that there are 12 different points that I make. This first little snippet, I'll address the first couple of points. So let's dig in. This is the first point, top of the first page, right at the upper corner. Let me play it once. This is just the first, let's see, 2, 4, 6 measures. Here's how it sounds, soft and up high, that you'll see. And rubato, no time. And maybe just a tiny bit more mezzo piano. And that's it. It's kind of a lovely little introduction. It's very sort of classical in nature at the beginning. And then it starts to use a tiny bit of those bluesy, gospel-y inflections as a sort of preamble to the song. So here it is. The first two iterations are exactly the same, and they are this. It's just a G chord, and for me, it's easy to put my pinkies on those Gs, and that frames the notes that I'll be using that are inside, that are between those poles. And gosh, I'm just using a G chord. And then it's these two notes that are the crucial notes, D and B. And I simply walk in a parallel fashion. I walk up and I walk down. It's really quite fun. So if you can use, I'm using my index finger and my index finger here. The fingering is not that important. And that essentially gets you through that beginning there. If you want to add on that note there, I actually add the G that's in the middle, but the 99% of it is this. While you're playing pinkies here. So here it is, the first stanza, the whole first measure, the whole first line of music. Same exact thing down an octave. Again, my pinkies are on those Gs. Down another octave, here's worth explaining just a tiny bit more. I use those inner, that D and that B, and they march up, and they march up again, and then down, and then the lower tone goes down again while the C stays, and then chromatically down again. So it's sort of a variation on that upper one. So here we have it. This is the second stanza, the second line of music. Both of those inner tones go up one, they go up one, down one, left hand gets that E flat, and then down again. You'll notice as well, there's some grace notes where I kind of like slide in. Those are delicious, delicious. Sliding in. So it's really cool. There's a fermata there, and that allows me to just cool out. And then these little hash marks, these little two lines, two parallel lines at an angle, are called a caesura. So we take a little break here. On to the second talking point. The major difference here is that we've established a sense of time. We've established a groove. It's awesome to have this groove. The beginning was wonderful. It's rubato. It just is freely felt. Rubato in Italian, to rob, to take away the time. But at number two, to actually give this gospel feel. So here I am, way back up high again, and I'm using essentially the same thing. This inner part, but here I sort of slide in chromatically. And that is definitely the DNA of this whole section. We have this, both go up, there's a lonely G here, and then they sort of slide into home plate there. I'll play it a few more times. So, happens here. Happens here. And now, as above, as it did above, there's a slight variation. Those two notes go up to here, they go down chromatically, they go down chromatically again, and then another reiteration of the. And that's it, that's that whole section. There's a beautiful little catalyst at the end of the first page that gets us chromatically into the next page. And it's just octaves, it's so easy. E octaves going up chromatically, triple chromatic approach from below, crow from below. And that gives you that nice beefy sort of sound. So here's number two, under tempo. Pardon me. Da, da, da. Last line. Time slower. One and two and one and two and. Same thing down an octave. Same thing down an octave and. At tempo. One, two, here it is and. And two and. And two and. So, super fun. I have a lot more points to make. So, hope you're having fun thus far. All right, on to page two. This is the third and fourth talking points. Take a peek at this second page. This is number three. I'll play it. It's just a simple eight bar thing here, and I'll play it slightly under tempo. Right there at the end of that, this is the eighth measure of that eight bar section. It says modified from the original. Excuse me, please. You'll hear in the original I do one of these things. The coordination is a bit cumbersome. By all means, feel at liberty to check out the pro advanced level here, and I explain how to play that and incorporate that. Suffice it to say, for now, I just say, you know what, gosh, we're doing a lot of octaves in the left hand. Let's just stick with the octaves together in a concerted fashion, that sort of thing. So right hand is this, just a simple G chord, and I have consolidated what I had done in the first page in two hands, with those both hands moving. This is actually a little bit easier because it just sort of sequesters that motion into the right hand. These two notes go up, a lonely G, and then slide in. So it's kind of a cool sound. That's it, just get used to that, it's wonderful. There's the G chord and I slide in, see those little grace notes, I slide into the G chord. The inner two notes go up one, a lonely G, and then So it's kind of a cool, and again, and again. And here, those two inner notes go up to D and F, and then chromatically down, and then the same thing. That's it. It's such an easy section. Really lays very nicely in the right hand. Left hand is so simple. It's just G octaves, and then that sort of triple chromatic approach. E, F, F sharp, G. Ba, 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 ba. Ba, 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 ba. That's it. We put them together. Here it is. The third talking point under tempo, slowly. One and two and one and two and. Left hand. Left hand. I'll do it one more time, even slower than that, just so that you can have this sort of the ability to perceive the coordination. On one level, it's easy because it's the left hand moving separately from when the right hand is moving separately. So that is kind of a helpful part of this. Ready and go and slowly. Oh, oh, oh. Not hard. I will mention this. You see two different kinds of accents, some that look like this and some that look like this. This is your traditional accent. You'll find it in classical music. There's no change of duration of the note. If it's a quarter note, it's going to be da. It's going to be a full beat, but it's got an extra punch to it. The accents that are like this, they have that extra punch, but they're staccato. This is called jazz staccato. So this is sort of like da. And this is like dot, like a staccato sound, dot, like that. So when you see the left hand, you really get a snappy feel. I mean, you can play the rhythm that's there, but it has no life to it. If you add those articulations, you add the life to it. Pow and two and one. Ba, 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 and two and one. Ba, 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 ba. So that brings the sparkle to that passage. Let's go on. This is the fourth talking point. You'll see there's a letter A there. This is the first A section in that typical Western way of thinking, A, A, B, A. So interesting that Beethoven used that 200 years ago. And people, you know, even to the present are still using that form, A, A, B, A. It was a huge part of Broadway and writing songs, Great American Songbook, jazz standards. So many of them are AABA in format. So it's a very typical thing here. And I made no modifications to that 8 bar, 8 bar, 8 bar, 8 bars. This is the first of the four iterations of 8 bars, the first A section, rehearsal 4 there, or talking point 4. And in short, this is a wonderful device, which is sort of flip-flopping, oscillating back and forth between a G chord and an A minor chord. Let's do an exercise together, you and I. Here's a G chord. I invite you to do that, G in root position, and take a moment to go up an inversion. So take the G off the bottom and put it on the top. Take the B off the bottom and put it on the top. Take the D off the bottom and put it on the top. All G chords, root, first inversion, second inversion, root, first inversion, and work that. Take the time to work through that so that that becomes fluent. 50% of the way there. Here's the other 50%. Just like a scale, the G major scale, starts with a chord tone in the G chord. This is a non-chord tone, but passes to a B, which is also in the G chord. Non-chord tone, which passes to a D, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We have these melodic passing tones. There are harmonic passing tones. Let's use A minor for that. Here's G in root position. Go to A minor in root position. And then duplicate that exact formula in each of the inversions. G major in first inversion, A minor in first inversion, G in second inversion, A minor in second inversion. It's really comfortable. There's no black notes here. It's super, super comfortable. So practice that, even if you pause this video, until you can fluently and easily oscillate between the two. G to A minor, G to A minor, G to A minor, etc., etc., etc. Now let's look at what I've written there. Here's the A section. Starts with a G chord, A minor, G. Rest, G to A minor. That's all it is. It's so easy. Back and forth, G chord, A minor chord, G chord, A minor chord. And the left hand is cake, just the G on the bottom. Okay, super, super, super easy. I'll stick with the right hand. I'll add some of those grace notes, those greasy, all those little greasy inflections, which give it such sparkle and wonder. Here's one of them. Here's another one. Okay, left hand is this, G, and then there's this little pickup at the end, which does this. I recommend three, three, two, one. Easy. And then at the bottom of the page, D, D. And the same thing. So here they are together. One and two slowly, ready and go and. One, two. Last time, ready and go and. Cool, more to come. All right, let's keep going. We're about halfway there. This is wonderful. This is the fifth and sixth points, page three. And so this is the second A section and the B section, or the bridge as sometimes people refer to it. So in this AABA format, this is the second A and the B section. Let me play the second A for you. It sounds like this. So there's some new stuff, not a ton, but there's some new stuff. I'll play it one more time, nice and slow. Ready and slow and on and. Pardon me. Ready and slow and. Let's start with the right hand. This is quite easy. And unlike the previous A section where we were always going back and forth between a G chord and an A minor chord, I kind of use that as a basis, but I go on from there. And you can see it right out of the gate. This is G, A minor, no surprises. But the next one is this. So it feels the same. They all feel the same. So it makes it quite easy to play. They're all spatially the same. That last one is G7. Isn't that marvelous? Because you get that seventh right there. And it does it again. And then it goes down, and it goes down. So all all of those chords in the whole first line, every single one of them feels the same way. Except the last one, which is this. Take a moment to process that. That's A on the top, E, C sharp, and B flat. It's kind of a little bit of a contortion to get that played. But that's the first line. It's really... Every time you see those little grace notes, adding those in make it so delicious. Second line of music. The right hand does this. G, G, A minor. Again, very similar to the first A section. And now instead of a regular old G like this, it's preceded. It's sort of like sliding in. Each note is approached chromatically. And then A minor. And then I'm just recycling exactly what was happening in the introduction. We talked about that already. So here's the right hand. Ready and right hand, one and. Same structure. Except here, this is diminished. One and. G to A minor, chromatic approach. A minor, and then the introduction. So the left hand is interesting. It's G, we expect that, that's the root, but it climbs up to here. Interesting, it's still a G chord, but I'm not using the root. I'm using the third of the chord, but it sounds great. There's a C, a little pickup of a G, and then there's your C. Chromatically up to the C sharp, and a D. Chromatically up to the D, and then just like the introduction. So the left hand is this, and go, and one, and two, and two, and two, and one. One, and two, and one, and two, ba 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 bum, beep, bo down. Beginning again. G and two and one and two and two and one da 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 dun, and two and one and two ba bum ba bum bum bum. So if you put those two things together, we have this nice and slow, ready and go and one and. That's it. So cool. Let's get on to the sixth talking point. This is the B section, the bridge, as some folks refer to it. This is that the entire first line of the bridge is all that same G to A minor, G to A minor, G to A minor. I know you know the melodies. So here's this B section where every melodic tone is sort of housed within either a G chord or an A minor chord. So it's similar to what I mentioned in the previous talking points. And the left hand just sits on a D for most of this. A minor to G. A minor, and then back and forth. So that's that whole first line of the bridge. It's not hard. A minor to G, G. A minor. Pickups to the last line is just one of those chromatic things again. Let's take a close look at the right hand here. Starts the same, A minor, G, A minor. Now here's interesting, grab these notes, C, E flat, F sharp, B. That's three from the end of the page, and it outlines a diminished chord. I love these chords, diminished chord. Two from the end is an E minor, an A7, and a D7. So we have cycle five. It's not that big of a deal. Last line of music on this is page three. Last line of music. A minor, ba, 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 diminished. E minor, A7, D7. Left hand is simply, oh, they're all octaves. D, and now it's D sharp marching up to F sharp. Ba ba bum. And then an E, C sharp, D. So in time, last line of music. This is the last four bars. Ready and go and. And to N. That's it. I'll put both hands together. This is the last line. N. One more time, even slower. Ready and go N. It. And there's a little appendage at the end that gives us a boost into the next section. Third finger on D, 3-2-1, low G. So that's it. In summary, I'll just bring some closure here. Here's the B section. 1 and 2, slow, slow and go and D, A minor to G. Same thing, A minors to G's. Chromatic. Diminished. E minor to A7 to D7. 3-2-1. And that gets us through that page. Amazing. I hope you're having fun. I love this. Oh my gosh. Onward. Let's see, that was talking point number 6. We have 6 more to go. All right, we're over halfway there. This is great. This is the 7th and 8th talking points. And in the music, if you're choosing to use that written PDF that I've provided, this is pages 4 and 5. Look for the 7 and 8 with the circles around them. So you'll see at the top of page 4, it's just another A section. You know, this is not really my 7th talking point, but I'll just at least interject here. There's some slight variations in that section. I'm happy to take a moment and play through it. It really just takes the left hand into a chromatic place. So if you'll see the left hand top of page 4, this is your G. And then there's a descending line. Now I've made an octave adjustment, but there's a descending line to an F natural, to an E, to an E flat, and to a D as well. And that last note, that D, is preceded this way. So it's really not hard at all. So we have this G to F natural, E natural, E flat, and then chromatically approaching the D. That's it. And if you marry that with the chords that are there, it's so delicious. Isn't that cool? We've done that before, and then the last little bit is right from the introduction. I'll play that A section just to button this up slowly. Ready and go and G. Descending line with the left hand, F, E, E flat, chromatically approaching the D. Et cetera, et cetera. Onward. So the 7th talking point, I don't have a ton to say other than that interlude is simply recycling what we've already done before. Here's that right at the number 7, here's this interlude, which happens twice. It's in repeat signs. That's it. You haven't played it as such before, but the ingredients are all things that we've talked about already. The consolidation of the with one hand and the chromatic. It's we've spoken of this already, but it's so neat to kind of compact that into like one, two, three iterations, and then it sort of breathes at the end. One, two, three, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I come out of that by just playing a G and allowing that sound to just kind of like percolate, to just be for a while, just be quiet for a moment and prepare for the next section. So we've done the an introduction and the AABA, the meat and potatoes of Joyful Joyful. This inner section is a solo section. And so the seventh talking point talks about what does it mean to be open for soloing, if you look at the bottom of page four. And at this intermediate level, you'll see in the video that I did, I was just flying freely and just allowing everything to sort of come into play here. But at this intermediate level, I might encourage you to improvise and to explore using two very easy tools. One is all of the white notes on the piano. This is G mixolydian. Perhaps you've heard that word before, perhaps not. It's not that big of a deal. It's a G major scale. But instead of do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, it's do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, te. And that mode, if you will, that scale is a wonderful vehicle for improvising over. Ready and go and. However you manifest that improvisation is up to you. I think what's most important is to choose a set of notes that are going to sound good, in this case G mixolydian. And the other is when you create phrases, when you say something musically, make sure it's more than just pushing buttons. Even though these are the quote-unquote right ingredients, unless you add some integrity to it, some intention, some deliberate construction of a phrase, it's just the Charlie Brown schoolteacher talking. It doesn't mean anything. So make sure, for me, it's all about groove and time. That to me is the lifeblood. So when I have this one, two, ready and go and bam. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I could have fun all day long doing that. As a matter of fact, there was another point I was going to introduce here, but I'm going to refrain from that. Mixolydian, in and of itself, is a bottomless well of options. Stick to that. We're lucky in this particular key, the topography, it's all white notes. Stick to that, but find great melodies, find great grooves, find things that could be repeated. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Finding really fun things to do musically. Onward. So here's the eighth point. If you look at page five, this is kind of a mantra, a coro, an ostinato, a tiny, tiny motif that's repeated over and over again. Here's the motif. Left hand does this. Couldn't be easier. B, C, D. Right hand, super easy. It's like a B-flat chord. I'm going to refrain from calling it a B-flat chord, but it looks structurally, at least, conveniently referred to as a B-flat chord. I don't think of it in those terms. So I've got these three first inversion chords. First inversion, first inversion, first inversion. It sounds mint with this. And if we create time as it's written, we have this. And two, and two, and. And that first one is jumping the gun. First one's long, and the subsequent two are short. Long, short, short, do, 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 do.
do. And what I've done here
is twofold. One is, in between those cracks, it allows you the space to improvise. As long as we can kind of keep that groove, good Lord, you could do that all day long. It sounds just great. If improvisation freaks you out, if it makes you intimidated, or if you're just unfamiliar with it, I've written three little iterations there. The top one, top of page 5, goes like this, which is so easy. A G and a G at the top, and then simple chromaticism. So. There's a second one that's this. So I play these three notes and I lift the C sharp. Gives you that sort of Pink Panther sound. And the third and last one. D and F, C and E. But the lower part is this, where you take that C sharp, and slide into C. Cool, I'm running out of time. I'll nip this one in the bud, more to come. Okay, just a few more to go. Here's 9 and 10. Coming out of an improvised section, sometimes I like to have a catalyst, a way to get back to what the head is, get back to what the given melody is. And what I've done here is I've actually written out a part that sort of uses a passing diminished chord very frequently in between diatonic points. Those are a lot of big words. Let me show you what it sounds like. This is talking point number 9 after soloing. Starts the same way as we did in the previous. But it uses these chords. That was the first one. And if you look at the music, this is measure 77, 76 and 77. I write the word dim or diminished. This is a diminished chord. This is D sharp down here, C, D sharp, F sharp, A. And I just love how that sort of like really pulls you into the next chord. It's just a delightful sound. So it starts this way, which we've done before. There's that diminished chord which pulls you to here. Here's another diminished chord that pulls you to here. And those eighth notes, the ones with the bars over them, the four notes that are beamed together, four chords, they're simply this. So easy. So here's the first two measures of the ninth talking point. And you'll see that what I've done is I put a dotted line over those two measures to remind us that the next two measures are exactly the same. And to remind us that the next two measures are exactly the same. I suppose I could have used repeat signs here, but there's a lot of black there. Don't be intimidated by that. Don't be scared by that at all. There's three iterations of exactly the same thing. And the fourth iteration is almost exactly the same. So here it is, the ninth talking point. We've done this before. This one actually has an E natural crammed in there. Passing diminished, E minor 7. Passing diminished,
and then just your standard G chord. This one happens to be in second inversion. And then each of these three are, they in a tactile way, they feel exactly the same. It's nothing. Same thing. Et cetera, et cetera. So I'll play it three times as it's written. First phrase, second phrase, third phrase. They are clones. They're exactly the same. Slowly. One and two. Ready and go and... I'm going to play it even slower. Now, you know, I apologize. I'm going so fast because I'm excited by the music. But what else is important here is a number of them, you'll really get this snappy sound if you play the chords staccato. Notice how in the first and second measures, there are just dots everywhere. Most all of the chords are played in a staccato fashion, like this. Really just jarring like that, but it gives it this very snappy, exciting sort of sound. Even slower. One and two, and here's the ninth talking point, 76. Even slower. Oh. Woo! I love it. I love it. The 10th talking point at the bottom of the page there starts the same. It starts the same. It does this. Same, same, same. And here's where it deviates. It does this. The G in the left hand holds. The right hand goes up to an A minor. And then there's a new chord, this. But I hope that your ears tell you that that sounds like those other ones there. It sounds like, because it is a passing diminished chord. It's wonderful. And it leads us to A minor 7. So this, the top of page 6, the first two bars, is sort of starting with an A minor centric thing. That's different than the other three iterations of that phrase. So here it is, at number 10. Same, 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 same. Here's where it's different. Left hand stays, and then we have this passing diminished A minor. I'm on page 6 now, page 6. G with B in the bass. A minor with C in the bass. Another diminished. It's just delicious. It's kind of a G6 chord with D in the bass. Another diminished. And then melodically, the right hand just has octaves. And the very last chord is this. So there's an E flat in the bottom. Harmonically, I'm thinking of the right hand, which is C minor major 7. C minor with a major 7, C minor major 7. What a beautiful sound that is. If you like theory, this is derived from melodic minor. From melodic minor. Amazing. So here is the 10th talking point, very slowly, very slowly. Same, 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 same. Six, this is A minor. Another diminished. Right hand only has octaves. New chord. In time, in summary, in closure here, 10th talking point. One and two and one and slow and. Diminished, 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 diminished.
Those hash marks are tremolo markings for last time. One, two, I'll play with the articulations and go. And into the 11th talking point from here. So just one more little segment and then we'll button it up. I hope you're having fun. I sure am. Couple more minutes of your time. All right, so here's some closure to this intermediate level tutorial of Joyful, Joyful. I may have misspoken earlier. I actually have three more points to make. They're labeled 11, 12, and 13. So let's get down to it. This is 11, and it's at the top of the last page. It's at the top of page 6, and it's simply this. It's this roll here, and I had mentioned this in the previous little segment of this video. This is a C minor major 7 with E flat in the bottom. And as a matter of fact, I like that E flat so much I do this. Play it down nice and low. And then I simply use octaves to do this. And I dress that up. And this brings us to that second stave, that second line, second stanza of music. And it also harmonically brings us to a place that's just a very standard Western way of thinking here. I've got the G chord in second inversion with that D underpinning, 6-4 as classical folk refer to it as, or theory folk. So we've got this C minor major 7, bum bum. It gives you that big fat sound, especially since I'm using this lovely low register of the piano. Second stave, second measure. I've got a little bit of a fill in there, but the fill, I mean, it's a lot of black notes in there, triplets, but it's just what I had mentioned earlier. It's sort of oscillating, alternating between G and A minor, G and A minor, G and A minor. So let's take a look at that. This is the second stave, second measure. A minor in second inversion, G major in second inversion. A minor in first inversion, G major in first inversion. A minor in root position, G major in root position. It's nothing, it's nothing. So one, two, triplets like this. One more time, triplets, and. Ba, 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 ba. Again, second inversion chords. First, root, that's all it is, so. Kind of a nice fill there. And then the last chord there is this. So easy. It's an A minor chord. I'm sort of alternating to the A minor, but I have a D on the top this time. And a lovely little riff getting us into the third bar. A third stanza, pardon me, third line of music. Kind of like the introductory material. So here is all of 11. As a matter of fact, I will start at 10 and get us into 11. Here's 10. Super, super, super fun. Okay, onward. I got much more to share with you. So for the 12th talking point, you can see at the end of that line, it says DSL coda. So the design takes you back to, I believe it's page 2
is the sign. Let's just confirm that. Sorry, I don't have that right in front of me. It is. So it's page 2. You'll see the sign, the little S sign with the line through it and the two dots and such. And they are the top of the form. They are the A section. What I want to leave you with here is a challenge, not much of a tutorial, really just a challenge. And that is, when you listen to my original recording of this, I indeed play the melody. I go back and I play this. But instead of playing, which is that very inside sound, I actually get very adventurous harmonically. This tutorial is not really a lesson in reharmonization techniques, although that will certainly be forthcoming in some lectures that I have. I love reharmonization. But let me at least give you a demonstration of what it means to play a given melody, but to choose chords that you would not maybe expect. Delicious. I love that so much. I could do that all day long. So I challenge you to do that as well, to try some things. Look, there's approaches and there's not rules, but there's some guides that you can use and that sort of stuff. But for here, if you've never done that before, and at this level, let me just have a gentle and general open invitation, which is, if you can abide by the melody, try mixing and matching and marrying different chords with those notes. It's so fun. Let your ear be the guide. Let your ear be the guide. 13th point and last thing. This is the coda. So the DS gives you the AABA format, the entire song again, which you can play as written. Again, it's very satisfying. You don't have to use my little reharmonization approach. But 13 is the coda, and this kind of buttons things up. It really is nothing more to teach, because it's just like the beginning. And again, just like the beginning. And here, pardon me, I held that G. So you see how that really is very tight. This is 3 from the end. There's a jazz staccato. Caesura, meaning pause, cut in time. Just a delicious C chord, really, with a D in there. C, add 9, add 2, if you will, whatever floats your boat. And then simply. So here's the coda, 13. Ready, and. As written. As written. For goodness sake. So there it is. I had such a fun time talking about this piece of music. And even though this is a slightly modified version, it still has, you know, 95% of what I have, maybe more, 96 or 97% of what I have in the professional or advanced version. If you are comfortable with this level, I hope you'll watch the other professional advanced level as well, and there's some extra stuff in there. Have a great day, have a great week, have a great month. I can't wait to share another piece of music with you. And I really am grateful for your support. I hope you're enjoying this video and these videos that I'm presenting and sharing with you. So, more to come.